you born?
I was born here, March 22nd, 1890. I began playing music in the Red Light District. That's where I come along playing the jazz music.
Storyville represents the last gasp of Victorianism in its desire to control human nature. No one, Alderman Story, the least of all, would have necessarily condoned the rise of jazz. But Storyville helped it along. For jazz musicians, it meant a place they could go and play the way they wanted to play.
Man, pretty much everybody be singing.
Yeah, what would you sing? You remember any of those numbers?
Oh, yeah. I know all them old numbers. I know them good. And I'll tell you a song. Listen, my honey, do while I try to show to you the dance they call the grizzly bear. Hug up close to watch, baby. Throw your heel toward the ceiling. That will give you funny feeling. Snug up close to watch, baby. Doing the grizzly bear. That's what he's singing them days.
I like that.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's good.
And all hell would break loose at those ham-kicking contests. See, they'd hang a ham from the ceiling for the girls to kick. And the men ate it up. They weren't wearing any drawers.
Men would be dancing with naked women on the floor. They would be in some corner smoking the shoshones, the weed, the reefer.
Does anybody know that gentleman's name?
High Society with your host, David Malmo-Levine.
Welcome to High Society. My name is David Malmo-Levine. This is the show about pot and jazz. And today with us, we have the incredible Bill Small, a jazz guitarist, aficionado, and amateur historian. Bill, welcome. To have you. And,
here.
It's always good to have you in that. Tell us, jazz, pot, they're like intertwined from birth. Isn't that right?
Totally.
Okay, yeah. tell us a little bit about the birth of jazz.
Well, in New Orleans, you know, in brothels, basically, that's, I mean, that's where everybody wanted to go. That was where everybody had the most fun, right? So we want to have a good time. It was all there. It's part of that culture and stuff. And
isn't that true that Louis Armstrong in Storyville, all that reefer smoking was taking place?
One time he was 14, every day of his life.
Let's see.
He learned the trumpet there, so.
He was busted, actually.
Yeah, more or less.
For pot in 31, I think it was?
Yeah.
Apart from his trumpet, Armstrong always carried two products on these trips. One was Swiss Chris.
One of the things that Louis swore by was laxatives. Now, Swiss Chris is an herbal laxative, and actually you can still get it, and it's a very legitimate, made up of a variety of herbs, or oibs, as Louis used to call it.
Singing that rock, 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 rock and roll from the east to the west.
He used to lay some of that on everybody, you know. Sometimes he'd make a tea out of it, you know. If you made a tea and you drank the tea, if the bathroom's from here to the way you're sitting, sometimes you didn't make it. You know, that's how ferocious it was.
The other was marijuana. Pot, as it was then known.
He considered it a tonic. It was something that was very important to his health. He started using it when he came to Chicago in the 1920s and used it throughout his life. It's an uncomfortable fact for many people who want to see him in kind of a pristine state, but he certainly didn't see himself that way.
Louis' whole day was planned with the show in mind. He'd go to bed. Before he went to bed, he'd take a double dose of Swiss Chris. When he got up in the morning, he'd roll a joint, go to the toilet, get high, and as he used to say, leave it all behind you.
We did call ourselves Vipers, which could have been anybody from all walks of life that smoked and respected Gage. You know, that's what we called him. That time, you know, in those days, that was our cute little name, Marijuana. And it was a misdemeanor in those days, much different from the pressure and charges the law lays on a guy who smokes pot. Pot is the later name, which is cute to hear nowadays. We always looked at pot as a kind of a medicine, you know? Yeah, in time, we discussed it or anything. I mean, enemy or trusting shit. Marijuana was a kind of medicine and a cheap drunk. A much better thought, and we had much better thoughts than one that's full of lush, meaning liquor. That's why I, for one, had to put it down, because the law comes to getting heavier and more, I don't know, they fell for that crap, but Gage is dope, you know, that shit. Well, anyhow, I had to put it down. But the respect for Gage will stay with me forever. I have every reason to say these words. And I am proud to say them from experiences, if no more.
In 1930, Louis went to Los Angeles and headlined at Sebastian's Cotton Club, where he won the admiration of numerous Hollywood stars. The trip ended in calamity, however, when he was arrested for smoking marijuana in his car with a white musician between sets. A shady manager from Chicago had his sentence reduced to a few weekends in jail, but Armstrong, who called pot an insulator against the pain of racism, continued to smoke it all his life.
Every night, on enemies and lovers, you know, go out and roll up a couple of joints of good Mexican grass. So, you know, Alvin Pops was out there, you know, and he would come out with what he would call his New Orleans Golden Leaf, which is very, very sad. It was terrible. Did nothing. You know, so funny thing happened when, you know, after a couple of weeks I noticed, you know, every time I was at a mission I'd go outside, you know, and Pops would be there, you know, sitting on the garden wall or on the tree, whatever we had available. And so finally one night I asked him, I said, Pops, I said, listen, you know, I noticed the last couple of weeks you don't come out with your New Orleans Golden Leaf anymore, you know. He said, shit, son, it's like bringing a hamburger to a banquet.
You could really tell when Pops was high. Pops was really low. And especially when he come back off intermission. When he come off intermission, Pops be ready.
Oh, I'm ready.